Welcome to another book review on the vlog. My name is Princess Irede Abumere. With me in the studio is Mimi Chaka. Mimi is a presenter and a documentary producer. Welcome, Mimi.
Thanks for having me.
Glad to have you here. So this time we're going to be reviewing Americanah by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. This book was published in 2013, 10 years after Chimamanda made her first debut with her novel Purple Hibiscus.
I love that, and I love this.
Okay, so before we go into our review, what is your all-time favorite Chimamanda book?
I would have to say Purple Hibiscus, because that was the first one I read. Mm-hmm. And I was just so eager to know more. You know, I had this hunger for, you know, African literature, and I felt like it served its purpose.
Let's now talk about Americanah. I remember before the cameras went on, you mentioned to me that you know this book like the back of your hand.
I know this book very well.
So for you, what were the qualities of the book that had you hooked into it?
I felt like because it was just so real. It was such a real book. Mm-hmm. It was a love story, which, you know, is a part of life. But it also was a book very heavily based on self-discovery. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt like Ifemelu discovered herself. You know, Obinze discovered himself. Everyone in their own way were discovering themselves, and that's life.
Let's give people a backstory. So this book, it follows the journey of two main characters, yeah. Obinze and Ifemelu, who are both more or less...
high school sweethearts.
Exactly. And it's set in an era where Nigeria was under military dictatorship and a lot of people were leaving the country. Yes. And Ifemelu lives, Obinze stays behind, he couldn't get an American visa, so he just follows their journey. Yes. Over 400 pages, and it's divided into three parts.
Yeah.
So them as teenagers, yeah. And then we see them grow, and the part where Ifemelu moves on to America, yeah. And then her return back to Nigeria.
To Lagos, yes. Yeah.
So what would you say about the main character, Ifemelu?
I absolutely, I love her, and sometimes I'm not too sure about her.
Why?
Because, and it's actually quite, she's quite a real person, mm-hmm. And I love her because at first she doesn't start out as this strong girl. Mm-hmm. Actually, she doesn't even know her strength, and she's not weak, but at the same time, she's not forceful. She's just going with the flow. She's just Ifemelu. And then when she gets to America, I feel she kind of sees her, she finds herself, you know, drowning in the midst of the Americanness, and, you know, she's now, you know, faking her accent, you know, texturizing her hair, and then she starts to discover, this is not me. And then later on, you know, she gets letters from Obinze, who's going through his own thing, and she's ignoring that. I was upset at her for that, but, you know, it's human. Sometimes you are going through so many things, you can't focus on, you know, you have to discover yourself and find yourself. Then she goes full circle, comes back to Lagos, and then I start to love her again. And she's a little more sure of herself. She's relaxed. She's not in a rush to, all the pressures of a Lagos woman isn't affecting her. She's found herself as a feminist, I believe, and she's living her truth.
I think, like, from when she was a teenager, there was hints of her courage in there, like her speaking up to her auntie, her speaking up to her parents, that was always there. Okay, let's talk about the other characters. What other character would you say you found interesting?
I actually found Auntie Uju very interesting, mm-hmm. because I felt like they had very similar paths, but Auntie Uju was a bit more of a go with the flow personality.
Yes.
And Auntie Uju wasn't trying to fight the system. And Auntie Uju wasn't trying to discover herself. She was like, I'm here, I have a child, I want to provide, I'm on and I'm going. Mm-hmm. And, you know, especially when
but this was Auntie Uju in America.
Because
Auntie Uju in America was different from Auntie Uju in Nigeria.
Yeah, exactly. She was a kept woman here. Yeah. And she was with the military man. He kept her in, was it Dolphin?
Yes.
Dolphin Estates. So I feel like it always, with life in general, mm-hmm. when you're, I would say, pampered and there's a harsh reality, it makes you numb. So I felt like Auntie Uju was just going with the flow because she was like, her heart had been broken and she wasn't trying to heal.
Yeah.
That's how I felt.
One character who I'd say stood out for me was Obinze's mother. So she was a professor at the University of Unsuka. Yeah. And I felt like she was an example or a role model for Ifemelu before she even realized the role that this woman played in her life.
Unlike her parents.
Exactly. Just the little things that she would do, such as, you know, she challenged somebody about stealing money in a meeting, and then the person slaps her, and she locks the boardroom and puts the keys in her bra.
Yeah.
She wasn't afraid to put people in uncomfortable situations just to get the truth out of them, or just to make them know you were doing the wrong thing. I really liked that about her. I liked that, you know, she was this strong woman who, she wasn't afraid of anything or anybody.
And you're right.
Were there any scenarios in the book that you would say, like, you felt like that was real life? Like, this actually, you feel like you could connect with?
You know what? As bizarre and random as this, there are so many, but as random as this is, the scene where she brings out the, I think, nuts to eat, where she's making her hair in the salad.
Yes.
And you could tell, the, you know, in her mind, the other girls are looking at her like, this one, she's not eating nuts. She's now of a different class.
Was it carrots?
It was carrots. I think it was something very healthy that they probably eat lard and, you know, and greasy food. So I felt like that was very real, because when you, you know, go to like maybe a lower end area to maybe do your hair or to get something, you most times feel, I wouldn't say judgment, but you feel the tension with the people there, because they almost feel like you've sold out in a way, not because of what you're eating, but the whole scenario looks like, oh, you're trying to be white, or you're trying to be better than us, or you're, you know, it just all becomes, so I felt like that was real.
What issues do you think the book was trying to address?
I think it was trying to address class system in Nigeria, you know, identity crisis as people generally.
Yeah.
And I say those two because, and feminism. I say those three because it was, I felt like with every page I read, I felt that in the book. The feminism was just her discovering herself when she, as she moved back here, and being able to say, I'm in my 30s, because I believe that's how old she was when she moved. I'm in my 30s, I'm not married, I live it by myself, I'm okay with that. And it takes a lot of self-love here to say, okay, that's what I'm doing, without the pressure of, oh, you should go to church and pray for a husband or whatever. And look at Obinze's wife, who is probably around the same age or even younger, and she Kosi is glorifying her marriage. It's on her head. She loves the fact that people tell her, you look biracial, you don't look like, you know, you're of Nigerian descent. And it's all those things that she, Kosi has been able to sort of lose herself in a marriage, because Kosi is a million other people. You know, she doesn't, you don't pick her out. There's so many other people like that. So I feel like that strength in being a woman is something that I saw from Ifemelu and other female characters in the book. The identity crisis here, I felt really strongly about it was DK's suicide attempt. You know, and there was a quote where Ifemelu is telling Auntie Uju, you didn't tell him, you didn't reassure him, you told him what he wasn't, but you didn't tell him who he was.
Yes.
And I felt like that hit me so hard, because most times, especially when you're of a different, you know, nationality and you're in a different country, it's good, and it's like, it's so important to know who you are.
But Auntie Uju seemed to be, she seemed to want to protect him, because I remember Ifemelu tried to speak Igbo to him and she said, no, do not speak Igbo to him, you'll confuse him. And Ifemelu wanted to say, but we spoke Igbo and English at home, and that didn't confuse me.
I think, I don't know if she was trying to protect him, as she wanted to him to put his best foot forward, and it was sort of a reflection of her own shortcomings.
Yeah.
Because she was like, okay, here I am, I've moved here, these are the things that are holding me back. My maybe Igbo tongue is holding me back. I don't want my child to have that, so that in America he will be able to soar higher, because people believe his Americanness. So in a way, she was just reflecting her, I feel, her own insecurities on him. But DK's suicide attempt, just, you know, it was subtle, but it was very impactful. So I love the fact that after that, Ifemelu was able to help him when he came back here to visit, to say, okay, these are your people, this is where you're from, know it, and know that you are loved.
I'd say, like, other topics that this book addresses is also race. So for a lot of people, you know, they always have this idea of, oh, you know, being African and then being Black American is one and the same thing. Mm-hmm. But this just, with Ifemelu's journey, we see that whole thing unraveling where it's like, no, we're all different.
Yeah.
And, you know, because of reading books and TV series with her boyfriend, Obinze, she had this idea of what America would be like.
Oh, they romanticized
and
it.
And her getting there and her realizing that, wait, it's this not is not what this is at all. And I felt like this book in 2013 was sort of the precursor for that whole natural hair movement going mainstream.
I went natural after reading this book.
Are you serious?
Yes, I did.
I felt like this was the first like open conversation that people had about natural hair.
That's true.
Because I remember when this book came out in 2013, I actually went to a book reading with Chimamanda.
Oh, wow.
And it was exciting to see her there. And there were men who were questioning this whole natural hair thing.
Oh.
They did not understand it.
Wow.
They didn't know that our hair grows differently, but we were putting relaxers, texturizing it to make it straight.
Wow.
This sort of subtly like addresses that, where, like you said, coming to your being as a woman, knowing your true self and understanding, okay, this is for me, this is not for me.
I absolutely agree with you. And I felt like when I read this book, there was just the self-acceptance that I felt when I read it. I was just like, I'm going to go natural and I'm just not going to keep going with the flow.
But other than self-acceptance, was there anything that you felt like you learned personally from the book?
I learned a lot. I'll say, besides self-acceptance, I learned a lot of overcoming, overcoming tragedy or adversity, having the strength. Actually, I learned a lot about strength. I know there was a transaction of cash with somebody that she shouldn't have been. And I felt like that's not the right thing to do, but it happened. You see, I feel like that's what I love about this book. It's so real. Like it's more or less a love story, but it had a lot of really hard pills to swallow. You know, Obinze didn't get his papers. He had to work with a false name in London. He never really cared about London. America was the big dream.
Yeah, it was.
And he had to deal with the fact that I'm not where I want to be. I'm not even doing anything legal. I'm planning on getting married to someone here just to, you know, things are not going well, but I'm going to keep pushing.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about Chimamanda's writing now.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think about the character development and how the characters grew?
I thought, you know, for an African literature, she really did hit like the head on, nail on the head with this one. I didn't really forget anyone.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like I really didn't get much from Ginika because
her
character was very, when Ifemelu got to America, her character was very strong and all of a sudden it kind of withered. But maybe that's how she felt about it. I wanted more from Ginika's side. But I felt like with every one of the characters, they were strong where they needed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And they were subtle where they needed to be. Same thing with even Ifemelu and Obinze's, you know, lead. Because they're like the two
yes,
leads.
Yes, they are. I mean, we go through this journey both through their eyes. Yeah.
Exactly. I felt like it was even. It wasn't like I was reading her bits and all of a sudden his is rushed.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like the story really unraveled nicely.
What did you think about how the book ended?
I loved it.
You did?
I loved it.
Do you know, the funny thing is that when this book came out, there were a lot of people who were like back and forth. They didn't like how it ended.
I cried.
So,
I cried.
Some people felt like it was predictable. I didn't feel like I could predict that was going to happen.
No.
But there were a lot of people who were not happy and people wanted more.
Okay, I actually had this conversation with my sister-in-law and she slammed the book and was like, this is not nice. I don't like the ending and this is and that. And I was like,
why
not?
I told you there were people who were emotional by the
yes,
ending.
She didn't like it, but I was emotional like because I loved it because I don't know. I just felt like we had gone through this journey and life has been hard for us and we're back and we found each other. And even in the midst of her finding her strong self and, you know, not trying, even when she met Obinze again, she wasn't falling at his feet.
Yeah.
She was still like, I know what I deserve. He still came back to her. But my sister-in-law's married. And I think the idea of...
Okay, so...
Spoiler alert.
Well, I feel like I say this on every episode, spoiler, but this is not a spoiler.
Yeah.
Book came out in 2013.
Yeah.
But Obinze, basically, he walks out of his marriage, moves out of
the home
that his wife and his daughter are in, and he has intentions of going back to see his daughter every day. We don't know how that is going to work.
Yeah.
But more or less, he comes to the realization that he should have never married Kusi.
Yeah.
And he should be with Ifemelu.
Yeah.
So it ends with him appearing at her doorstep.
And I think he says, I'm still going to keep chasing you
until you give me a chance.
Ceiling, come upstairs. Oh my god. Oh my god. It was literally so romantic. I don't know. I felt like that was a perfect ending for me because it wasn't really an ending.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't live happily ever. We don't know.
We don't know.
But it was the fact that he knew this was home for him. She was home for him. In the same way she felt safe with him. You know, and it's really difficult. There's so many people in the world. 6 or 7 billion. But Ifemelu feels safe with Obinze and they found each other again. So that's how I felt.
How would you describe this book in one sentence?
In fact, one word, sensational.
Brilliant. Brilliant. And I don't know if you guys know the news already, but Lupita Nyong'o has bought the rights to this book.
I know that.
It's going to be produced as a TV series. So we're all looking forward to that.
The actors better bring their A game because these characters they're great.
I'm sure they will. Thank you so much, Mimi.
Thank you for having me.
All right, that is all for today. If you got a book that you want us to review, please drop a comment down below. Remember to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the BBC Africa YouTube channel. See you later.